Today, we are going to learn how EPR spectroscopy can enable us to study anisotropic interactions. That is, today's topic is anisotropic interactions and EPR. What is anisotropic interactions? Anisotropy is something which means that some property depends on the direction. Now, there are many properties that depend on the direction. One very familiar example is the way some substance behaves to a force that you apply from outside. Here is a simple example. We have this ruler. I will apply some force on this and try to bend it. Now, if I apply force this way, see how easy it is to bend it. But if I try to apply force in this fashion, then it is very, very difficult. See, in other words, this is an object. The way it responds to my force depends on in which direction I am applying the force. So, this response of this object is anisotropic. In a similar manner, the beams on the ceiling are given this sort of shape. That is, this side is wider and this side is thinner, and the load is carried along this direction. So, the example that I gave on the ruler is essentially applicable here also. The way this beam responds to the stress is not same in all directions. In magnetic resonance, many phenomena are anisotropic. We have not considered them so far. All we have assumed is that the electron-Zeeman interaction, for example, is isotropic, and the way we wrote is Hamiltonian was written as G beta I this fashion. So, this was considered a scalar quantity. We also considered the isotropic hyperfine splitting constant, which is written as A times I dot S. This is also a pure number. But we did mention that electron nuclear dipolar interaction is a directional dependent interaction, which we have neglected so far. So we will see those things here, and then how far of this thing can be applicable or needs to be modified. At the outset, we should keep in mind that a paramagnetic species which is undergoing sort of rapid tumbling in a solution, for example, then it experiences all possible orientations very quickly. So, what property will measure for this sort of system is an average property. So, all the directional dependencies will not be seen in the experiment, except to a certain extent the average value of this directional dependent properties will be seen there. So, to get the true directional dependent properties, we must stop this motion as far as possible. So, one way to do is to study the solid state system or in powder form, where the tumbling motions are almost gone, or have a solution, but freeze it to a very low temperature, so that it is a frozen solution sample, and again the tumbling motions are substantially stopped. We have seen many times earlier that angular momentum of an electron can come from either spin motion or orbital motion, and both orbital motion and spin motion can give rise to the respective magnetic moment. The magnetic moment for these two motions are written in this fashion. This is the magnetic moment due to the spin motion. G E beta E S is the spin angular momentum, where G is usually 2.0023 and something like this. And similar to orbital motion, this could be exactly similar fashion. We write G of L is actually 1. So, here both the equation says that this vector and this vector are parallel to each other. Similarly, this and this are also parallel to each other. Now, if a paramagnetic species has both this angular momenta, then they can combine together according to the quantum mechanical rules of addition of angular momentum. Let us say this J is the total angular momentum made up of this L plus S, then this will also produce a certain net magnetic moment, and I can write by adding this to something like mu of J could be written as now here by analogy of these two equations I am tempted to write that something like, let us say this angular momentum and some sort of g factor, let us call it g of j, and this is written strictly on the basis of the similarity that S gives mu S, they are parallel to each other, L gives mu L, again parallel to each other. So, this equation is fine, it is an addition of these two, but can I write an expression of this kind that mu J, that is magnetic moment arising out of the total angular momentum, is something, some constant here, this gives the proportional constant between this and this, is it possible? Now, if this is true, of course, then this and these are going to be parallel. And we are going to see in a moment that this net magnetic moment does not become parallel to the net angular momentum. Let us see how that is possible. So, using this one, let us say I have got this is let us take this one first, that is L vector, and this gives the angular momentum of this magnitude and corresponding magnetic moment which points in the opposite direction because of the negative sign, G L is equal to 1. So, let us say this is my mu due to L, then I have the spin angular momentum, let us say this is the magnitude of that and the direction, and this angle is such that these two can be added according to the laws of addition of angular momentum given by quantum mechanics. Now, the corresponding magnetic moment due to S will be twice the size of this one, because this is value of this is 2. So, this is mu of S. The net of this and this is given by this addition rule of vectors. So, this gives the vector J. Similarly, the net of these two magnetic moment is given by this addition, this is the mu of J. Now, it is obvious from here that because this is twice this one, this vector cannot be parallel to this one. Therefore, I cannot write equation of this kind, that is I cannot have a some g factor which gives a magnetic moment associated with the net angular momentum. This cannot be a pure number, that is not possible. So, what is the remedy? How do I proceed that this is not possible? We can do it two ways. We can use this total angular momentum expression the way we have written here and the corresponding magnetic moment. So, now, g l is 1. So, let us write 1 now, we do not have to write that. G of s, and with this I can write the interaction of this magnetic moment in a magnetic field in this fashion. Now, this is very nearly equal to 2.0023, let us write 2, which is approximately quite acceptable. This is the way one can write the Hamiltonian, which is fine. Another way of doing it is to say that because this cannot be parallel to each other, I cannot use a pure number. So, how about using a 3x3 matrix here? Mu of j is something I write in this fashion, where this is a 3x3 matrix. Let us call it G x x. Then this and this need not point to the same direction. So, both are acceptable, only the approach is different. Here the approach is that we just treat this interaction by assuming that the interaction could be written as using this type of G matrix, that this could be replaced as this one. So, here we treat this S to be some sort of effective spin angular momentum and the interaction can be written in the same fashion. That is, we do not explicitly think of the contribution of orbital angular momentum. The effect of this is to make these two nonlinear. So, that is taken care of by changing g from a pure scalar number to a 3x3 matrix, and this therefore is considered to be an effective spin angular momentum, and that gives the same interaction which is given by this one. We will take this approach because it is easy, sort of easy to visualize what is happening, but nevertheless both are equivalent approach there. So, here when I define this, of course, we need to define a coordinate system. So, this could be some coordinate system to start with, where the maybe parametric species is kept here. Let us say this is the x, y, and z. Now, in this product, we have to keep in mind how these three items are multiplied. This is shown here. So, as I said earlier, that mu is written as the product of this 3x3 matrix with this effective spin angular momentum, giving rise to this sort of multiplication. So, here B is the magnetic field written as a rho vector, because that is the way the multiplication has to be carried out for compatibility of the rules of compatibility with the rules of matrix multiplication. Now, with this one, S is taken to be the effective spin. So, in a magnetic field, this will give rise to two energy levels, E1 and E2. So, this could be written as energy of this will be G of effective and this will be similarly plus G of effective total energy delta E is G of effective beta I B. So, what is the G effective now? So, once again, if you look at it, that this two terms together gave some sort of effective magnetic moment which is interacting with this magnetic field. But we can look at it differently also. That is, we look at it as this is an effective magnetic field which is interacting with the spin angular momentum, and that is the way the energy levels can be thought of. That so, this gives effective G value for a given value of the magnetic field B here, and the energy level is split. Both are equivalent actually, the how we look at it. So, this gives the effective spin that is interacting with the magnetic field here, or this gives the effective magnetic field which is interacting with the spin. Now, with that idea, now if this is the way it is, should be able to get some expression of this in terms of these things. Total energy square, this is a scalar quantity, can be written as a scalar product of this with itself. So, that is done here, this delta E square is product of this with this. Of course, here too, again to make sense of the multiplication of vectors and this matrices, this have to, one has to take the appropriate transpose of the matrix here, that is done here. So, then by simplifying, the G effective square with these two constants gives comes out to be this here. The B x, B y, B z are the three components of the magnetic field. So, if B is let us say I B x is the three components, and the magnitude of this is given by this. Then one can write this three components in terms of the direction cosines of this B with respect to the external coordinate system that we had earlier. So, L x, L y, L z are the direction cosines of B in the similarly here. So, then B square comes out, and then this quantity G f effective square is actually is this which is written here. G effective square is the direction cosines of the magnetic field, and square of this G matrix. Now, so the square matrix is defined by taking the product of these. Now, if you see this matrix and is the transpose of this matrix. So, no matter whether G is symmetric or not, this will always be a symmetric matrix. That is very important. So, then because G square is a symmetric matrix, now we can choose a suitable coordinate system. So, initially I had some coordinate system whatever it is in the laboratory, and the experiment is done, and this is the paramagnetic center sitting here. And with respect to this x, y and z, the G square matrix here was defined. Now, because it is symmetric matrix, I can have a special coordinate by suitably rotating this one, so that the G square matrix becomes a diagonal matrix. So, this special coordinate
let's say capital X, capital O, and capital Z are the special coordinates with respect to the molecule, so that this becomes diagonal, G square matrix is diagonal. So, if it is square root of this 3, then I get G x x, G y y, and G z z. These are called the principal components of the G matrix. So, here if the magnetic field is now pointing towards either this special coordinate or the principal axis capital X, capital O, and capital Z, then you see the equations becomes very simple now. Then the magnetic moment along that particular direction x becomes beta I g x x s x, which is what we always get, that this type of thing. But then this, the important thing is that here the magnetic field is pointing to one particular direction of the molecule, that is the principal axis. Similarly, for S y and S z, and if the corresponding energy of transition will be, if the magnetic field is along the x direction, then h nu is beta g x x is v x. Similarly, for the others. See, in general, the magnetic moment can be written in terms of this principal component g x x, g y y, g z in this fashion, where capital X, capital O, and capital Z are the unit vectors which are pointing towards this principal axis. This is shown here. So, these are the principal axis. Let us say B is pointing along this, then effective G square, which is from this expression, that diagonal element appears to be this. So, these are the three direction cosines of B with respect to this principal coordinate. So, this shows that the interaction depends on directions, and depending upon the value of this G x x, G y, and G z z, one can get complicated EPR spectrum. As the angle changes, the effective G value changes, therefore, the spectrum will also change. Now, how different these three values are, that will tell us about the symmetry. So, we have got three principal components. If all three are same, then we call this an isotropic system. Or G is isotropic. This is what we have been actually using so far in our previous examples. The G does not depend on the direction. Okay. Other possibility, let us say two of them are equal, third one is not. Then we will call this system to have an axial symmetry. And if all three are different, then we can say this is a rhombic symmetry. In a sense, no symmetry. So far as the G values are concerned. To get interactions of this kind, the molecule has to be kept in a frozen solution or in a crystal. So, right now, let us consider the situation in crystals. So, crystals have certain symmetries. So, if the parametric center is sitting in this crystal, they will experience the local symmetry. Now, local symmetry could be cubic symmetry here, or it could be a uniaxial, where there is a axis, one axis of symmetry. So, that is, if it rotate in this fashion, it will be at least three-fold axis of symmetry should be there, or rhombic symmetry, no symmetry axis higher than C2 here. So, when I said rhombic symmetry is no symmetry, that is not quite correct. Just the crystal can have C2 symmetry, but there is no symmetry axis higher than C2. If there is higher than C2, then C3 or C4, then it will be either here or here. For example, here this one has C4 axis of symmetry, this has C4 no doubt, but it also diagonal if you take, it will have C3 axis of symmetry. Now, for cubic symmetry, a cubic symmetry is essentially will give rise to this isotropic G value. these are various subclasses of cubic symmetry. It is a cube, well, in a sense, indeed a cube. All these lengths are same, or the way the atoms are placed, or it could be octahedral, or it could be tetrahedral. These are all subclasses of cubic symmetry, and all of them have an isotropic G value. Now, we take some examples of if you are in crystals. In a single crystal, all radicals are oriented in the same way. So, by changing the orientation, and the resonance position of the magnetic field will change for all the radicals in the same way. As you rotate the crystal, all the radicals which are inside will experience the same magnetic field. Now, here is an example of a paramagnetic center trapped inside a sodium chloride crystal lattice. Here, this block or the square is the place where a chloride atom should have been there, but that has disappeared to make a vacancy, and instead a single electron is residing here. So, these are some defect centers or color centers type of names given to this. Now, so this is the center of paramagnetism. So, here this belongs to this octahedral symmetry. You can see the four nitrogen sodium atom, and the one at the top of the bottom. So, here this is purely octahedral. So, that belongs to this. Okay, three values to be same, and so G value will be isotropic. What is the experimental observation? That if I take this system, let us say crystal, and do the EPR experiment as a function of magnetic field. So, this will give a spectrum something, let us say here, and you keep rotating the crystal around certain axis, and this will not move, it will be precisely at the same place. That is the same thing what I have been trying to say, that G value is isotropic and it does not depend on the orientation of the crystal with respect to the magnetic field. So, this remains constant. See, this is the place which gives me the value of V0. Then the G value will be correspond to this one, and this is not going to change no matter which direction the magnetic field is applied. In contrast, there is another such vacant center here, magnesium oxide crystal. Again, there is a defect is created where magnesium atom has disappeared. It was done by irradiating this crystal with X-ray. Now, so that magnesium ion has disappeared, and at the same time this O2 minus oxides were there. From one of those, this one electron was knocked out. So, this O2 minus becomes O minus. Now, in the process, the position of this thing has got slightly moved from the normal usual position here. Usual position is they very similar to this octahedral symmetry, but because this has gone, and so therefore, there is some little repulsion between this and this. So, that repulsion pushed this away from that. So, this therefore, is no more a cubic symmetry. So, it has a symmetry axis along this direction now. Now, for this the G value is dependent on the direction. That is, if you do the same experiment here and rotate the crystal, the position is going to change in certain way. And wherever it changes, I get a effective G at that particular orientation at that magnetic field. So, once again, so this is the symmetry axis, C4 axis is here, and let us say B is magnetic field is applied along this direction, which makes an angle theta, and this is the perpendicular direction. So, here if the crystal is rotated around this C4 axis, then because the symmetry axis, the interaction is not going to change. So, this will be staying right here wherever it is. On the other hand, here the interaction depends on the angle. So, if this angle is varied in the yz plane, then the effective G is going to change, that will be seen as the change of the line position. Okay, this is the result here. So, you see that angle is varied from 0 to 180 degree. So this is the position of the EPR signal in the magnetic field unit. So it starts with 3.2, 3.3.1 Gauss, and as the angle is changed, this becomes smaller and smaller, and somewhere at 90 it reaches minimum, again it goes back here. So for so it starts from here, goes down, 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 again goes back. So for each orientation one can determine the G value, and this is the shown here. As the angle is varied, G changes from 2.0033 to 2.0386. Now this is 0 and 180 degree is nothing but the magnetic field is pointing along the direction of the symmetry axis. So we call the G value to be G parallel value, and 90 degree is this direction, so that is the G perpendicular value. So this expression can be fitted to an expression of this kind, G parallels and G perpendicular expression, and the angle is theta. So that is for axial symmetry. For rhombic symmetry, where all three are different, the expression for effective G is given here. It depends on all the three principal component of G, and also the angle that the magnetic field makes with respect to the principal axis. Now, to determine this, EPR spectra are recorded by rotating the crystal successively in xy, yz and xz planes. Then for this measurement, each of them will give a curve of this kind, then the corresponding elements of this G square matrix. I have got this, these elements could be determined from this measurement, and then one can now diagonalize it to get the principal component of the G matrix, and then also the angle of the principal component of the G matrix that gives rise to the anisotropic interaction. Now, that is the way one can study the single crystal and find out the corresponding anisotropic interactions, but it is not always easy to form single crystal. So, the experiments are difficult in that sense. So, what one does is that one can freeze a liquid solution, a paramagnetic sample, and then try to see if one can get similar results from studying the EPR spectrum of a frozen solution or powder, for example. If the crystal is not formed, one can do EPR on powder samples, but then the main problem is that in powder and frozen solution, the magnetic moment of paramagnetic particles will point to all possible directions with respect to the external magnetic field. So we have randomly oriented spin system. So here we need to find out that how these random orientations are reflected in the spectrum of the EPR signal when recorded in case of powder. For crystal, for example, as the orientation changes, this magnetic field position change. For powder or frozen solution, similarly there will be magnetic field direction. This is the signal. So as the different orientations are available in case of powder, so this will also have certain range of allowed magnetic field. As we have to find out whether all such magnetic field positions are equally likely or there are some selectivity. It is very obvious that all orientations are equally likely. So we are going to see that that is that even though all orientations are equally likely, these all magnetic field positions are not equally likely. So first let us find out therefore that how many magnetic moments will point to certain direction. Here for let us say the case of axially symmetric G. So these are we have to find out how many molecules will point to this direction given by r theta and phi, and r remains constant, theta changes from theta to d theta here, and since the axial symmetric, the G does not depend on the phi. So for all values of phi, so that happens to be the this particular band here. It is easy to see that area of this band is 2 pi r square sin theta d theta, but total surface area is 4 pi r square. Therefore, the probability of finding a vector pointing towards the shaded region is given by the this divided by this, which is sin theta d theta by 2. Okay. Now, these vectors which are pointing in this direction will give the same in the neighborhood of same magnetic field in the EPR spectrum. So, where are they going to appear? Maybe they will appear somewhere here, let us say. Now if theta is changed now, the resonance position is going to change somewhere here. So, when we cover all the possible orientations, how these distributions are going to be appearing at different magnetic field region. So, that is p theta d theta, which is already found out with this, should be proportional to some distribution of intensity as a function of magnetic field B to dB. So, PB is just this divided by this one. So, we have to find out this relationship. B is equal to h nu by g beta e. Now, you have seen that for axially symmetric g, this is the relationship. So, you just do the algebra that is necessary to simplify this. So, B is given by this relation, and that, but g itself is given by this. So, if we do the differentiation, the PB happens to be in this fashion. So, this, let us take a closer look at that. That means, all values of magnetic field orientations are not allowed here. It can range from, let us say, g perpendicular value to g parallel value. This is the range of allowed B, and as the cos theta changes from 0 to 90 degree. And for each angle, the B is given by this relationship. So, for the angle theta, I find B, that B is put here and here to find out the value of the probability. Here, see, the moment cos theta becomes 0, this shoots up. So, this goes to very, very, very large value, but otherwise, it smoothly comes to maximum up to B parallel. So, of course, this here, this going to infinity is not a very serious issue, because this transition's width are supposed to be 0, but once we give finite width, then they all sort of broadens up and the sharp edges are gone. So, this is given here. The blue has a very small width of transition 1 Gauss, then as width becomes bigger and bigger, see how they become less rugged. Now, here the g perpendicular value is here correspond to this magnetic field, and g parallel will be correspond to this magnetic field. So, we can get the corresponding values from this powder spectrum as well. But in practice, we do not get the absorption spectrum, we get the derivative spectrum. So, we have to take derivative of this one, and that is the way this looks like. So, here, so if you take the derivative of this, this will actually go up and come down, and here again, that is going to be. So, this point is corresponding to here, and this point corresponds to this one. So, g perpendicular will be corresponding to this magnetic field position, and g parallel corresponding to this magnetic field position. So, that is the way it is going to be. So, these are the example for the magnesium oxide vacancy, and g perpendicular is here, g parallel here. Now, for rhombic symmetry, we have to do the same calculation, but a little bit more complicated. Instead of the shaded area, now here we have to see the probability the vector points to a certain only small region here, that is r square sin theta d theta d phi somewhere here. And then as theta and phi varied, how this similar distribution is going to change with the condition that g square is given by this relationship. So, here the absorption profile looks like this, the given by the dotted line with a where the transition has no width, but with a finite width, this colored line is the appearance of the spectrum. Now, again if you do the derivative, then the signal will look like something like this. This is the gxx, gyy, gzz. This zz is the one, is taken to be the one which is farthest from the other two. So, here is the gzz, and gyy is the intermediate values. And here is an example that this CO2 dot, this is one radical which is trapped in the magnesium oxide powder, and this is the gxx, somewhere here gyy and gzz. Okay. So, with this, now we take the next item, which is electron nuclear dipolar interaction. We have seen this is the interaction which is highly directional dependent. On the other hand, isotropic part is given by this sort of expression, dipole double interaction is this. So, both of them have this type of S dot I type of interaction here. This also has S dot I. So, we can as well add this isotropic interaction, dipole double interaction, to get a single expression which looks like this. I is the nuclear spin, A is now a matrix, 3 by 3 matrix, and S is the spin angular momentum, and A here now is automatically symmetric because of the way this D is defined. But here if you take the average of this diagonal element, this turns out to be 0, that is average dipole interaction is 0. That is again in tumbling motion is fast, in solution one does not see this, but it is not true in frozen solution or in crystals. So matrix A is symmetric, hence it is again similar to this, we should be able to diagonalize the matrix by choosing suitable axis. These are the called the principal axis of the hyperfine matrix. Now average of this three principal component will be nothing but A 0, obviously, because that is the way these are added, that we add this constant isotropic value. So that is the average value is the sum of all this, and anisotropic values are now given by these two parameters. B 0 gives how far the z is different from the other two, and C is how this other two x and y are different from each other. So B 0 and C 0 are called the anisotropy parameters, and in particular B 0 is called uniaxiality parameter and C 0 is called the rhombicity parameter. Now again, single crystal in principle one can find out the orientation dependence of the EPR spectrum, and axially symmetric case, see this equation looks very similar to G anisotropy. And in frozen solution again the same type of relationship can be derived as we did for G anisotropy. Now here are some type of patterns we can get. Axially symmetric, I is half, if C 0, that is axially symmetric. Now B 0 defines how far it is deviating here in the axiality parameter here. So you see B is 0 means it is really isotropic, so you get two doublet line. Now as B 0 changes, which changes the xi, you get the various types of patterns. So these two patterns particularly you can recognize that they are very similar to axially symmetric G type of thing. So in each of the hyperfine transition I get similar pattern. As the xi becomes smaller, they come closer and closer and closer, and they give all sorts of pattern of this kind. It is also possible that G matrix and A matrix are both present, the isotropic G and isotropic A, so they can have this type of appearance. Then here isotropic G, that is all three transitions here, the pair of transition corresponding to AX, AY, AZ, has the center value of all three of them are same, so G is isotropic. On the other hand, G is axially symmetric, then I can get this two center of this and this is corresponding to A perpendicular, center of this and this is the distance between this and this is A parallel, and center of this is G parallel, so this and this are different, these are different therefore, but values are also different. But here in another place isotropic A, where A 0 is same for all of them, there is the gap between the corresponding lines are same, but the G is not isotropic, so these are three different values of G. So that way one can get various types of combination and identify the anisotropic contribution and the parameters of G and A from this powder pattern as well. So we have seen how the EPR studies on single crystals, powder or in frozen solution, one can determine all the anisotropic interactions arising from G and A. This slide shows the two textbooks from which we have taken much of our material in this lecture.